Today we're going to talk about effective messaging and framing on racial equity advocacy. Let's take an example. Two news stories distributed by national media. In the first example, we have a young black man wading through waist-deep water with food, and the reporter highlights that he has been looting stores in search of food. The second example highlights a white couple wading through waist-deep waters and highlights that they had found food. Two people doing exactly the same thing, but labeled differently.
We're being divided by race through a new sort of racial rhetoric that operates in code. So things like welfare cheats, illegal aliens, these are terms that are operating like dog whistles. Right. On one level, you can't hear the race because there's no surface reference to race. On the other, they're triggering tremendous racial anxiety, and what they're doing is they're making people afraid of minorities, but also afraid of government. Obamacare. Ostensibly, this is about health care, but really it's about Obama and government policy. Now, Obama himself has been subject to a lot of dog whistling, that he's foreign-born, not a citizen, a Muslim. What's happening with the term Obamacare is all of these insinuations are being attached to a government policy. The most recent one, Obamacare makes you lazy. Lazy, of course, is one of these racial code words for minorities. So every time they talk about the Affordable Care Act, they're going to use that term Obamacare. And the subtext is, here comes a black man who exemplifies the way in which the federal government is now by and for minorities. Don't trust the federal government. Don't let this into your household.
The use of racial coding had its origins in the infamous Southern strategy devised by Harvey Lee Atwater. Atwater, advisor to U.S. Presidents Richard Nixon, Ronald Reagan, and George Bush, relied heavily on anti-black symbolism. For instance, Ronald Reagan began his August 1980 campaign kickoff speech standing beside a known segregationist a few miles from Philadelphia, Mississippi, a town notorious for the murder of three civil rights workers in the 1960s. His speech stressed his belief in states' rights, code for the blocking of black advances. Atwater talks about the transition from overt to coded racism in a now famous interview with journalist Alexander Lammas. He starts with an overt racial epithet.
You start out in 1954 by saying nigger, nigger, nigger.
He then moves to coded phrases.
By 1968, you can't say nigger, that hurts your backfire, so you say stuff like forced busing, states' rights, and all that stuff.
Economic codes is the next phase.
And you're getting so abstract now, you're talking about cutting taxes, and all of these things you're talking about are totally economic things, and the byproduct of them is blacks get hurt worse than white.
Finally, Atwater talks about how abstract and coded phrases can use existing prejudices to drive policies that hurt people of color without mentioning race.
That if it is getting that abstract and that coded, we're doing away with the racial problem one way or the other.
Atwater's strategy continues to this day. A more current coding of race implicitly denies that race makes a difference in life outcomes for people of color. That coding is the notion of colorblindness. The conflict between the colorblind frame, all lives matter, versus the race-explicit Black Lives Matter is at the heart of our next communications example.
Let's start with Black Lives Matter and look at three assumptions that are built into the messaging. First, that black men are targets by police and the criminal justice system. The second assumption is that black voices are silenced. And the third assumption is that currently black lives are not valued by police or the criminal justice system.
Now let's talk about the phrase, all lives matter. Our example is from the group, the Oath Keepers. There's implications contained in this message as well. Number one, there's an implication that all of us have similar experiences. Number two, there's a disagreement that black men have even been singled out by the police. Another implication, that the lives of police officers who have difficult jobs have been disrespected. And last, The idea that police actions against black people are legitimate and protests should be silenced. Are these messages based on fact? Every 28 hours, a black person is killed by the police, a security guard, or a vigilante.
The truth is, facts don't always matter. Most people ignore facts that do not fit into their current understanding of the world or the current narrative that they hold.
What happens when we take the frame and repackage it using another angle and different language?
The organization Gun Saves Lives points to criminality in the black community, arguing black lives matter at the expense of white lives. A similar critique from the All Lives Matter advocates used by the Radiance Foundation. We see the value of black lives compared to black homicides and abortions. Radiance is using their anti-abortion frame to mock both the idea that black lives matter and the movement to reform the criminal justice system. Significantly, one of the key spokespeople for Radiance is Ryan Bomberger, who's black. Messengers matter.
This Black Lives Matter poster offers a more explicit counter. It refers directly to the police with hands up, don't shoot. And second, the graphic displaying of the American flag blacked out in the background conveys that the mistreatment of blacks goes against American values. Finally, Black Lives Matter directly confronts All Lives Matter. In this poster, what is called out is the focus on black lives being critical in this particular moment. What can we discern from examining these messages and counterframes? First, the assumptions that underlie each of the messages are grounded in an analysis of the way the world and racism work. Messengers and images matter. The tape over the mouth image says a great deal about how advocates perceive the problem, as does the use of the flag and having a white advocate hold the sign that critiques. While the messages are fairly simple, the frames and metaframes are not necessarily explicit for either message. In order to create successful messages, we will need to consider how to keep our message consistent and to choose audience-appropriate messages, messengers, and methods of delivery.
At the Center for Social Inclusion, we've been trying to figure out how to craft effective counter-narratives. Over the last few years, we've conducted two national surveys looking at how best to talk about race in policy change. What we found is that people are more likely to affirm progressive messages that are racially explicit, that name race. After we've figured out what outcome we want from our audience, we can craft a message that is consistent with our values using a conceptual tool we call ACT. ACT. ACT stands for Affirm, Counter, and Transform. First, affirm. Start with a heart, lead with an emotional appeal. Explain why we're all in this together. Try to find a place where we have shared values or shared fate. Next, counter. Explain why we have the problem. What is the history of this issue, especially being explicit about its relationship to race? Take on race directly. Name it in your story. Transform. Reframe who the winners and losers are in your narrative. And again, end with the heart or with an emotional appeal.
Now, let's use this ACT tool with a real-life example. Let's talk about education. Currently, many school districts have disproportionality in high school graduation rates. In some school districts, only about half of African American, Latino, and Native American children graduate from high school on time. This phenomenon has a dominant narrative. The dominant narrative focuses on cultural deficits. It focuses on the failures of individual children and families instead of the institutions and structures. We can use the ACT model to develop a counter narrative. We need to affirm that all children deserve a high quality public education. Counter, we need to pull in that data and say that yes, only 50% of African American, Latino, and Native American children graduate from high school on time. We understand that there are multiple factors contributing to these outcomes. However, some are more significant than others. So we are focusing on one factor that will have a significant and immediate impact. Harsh punitive discipline based on subjective infractions is a major factor driving disparate outcomes. We need to change that policy. Transform. We need to change the system of subjective disciplinary infractions into one that focuses on restorative discipline and is effective for all of our children. Now that we've gotten the hang of using the tool, let's try a little bit more complex of an application, this time in the arena of sustainability. We know we want to start with the heart. The health of our children, families, and loved ones depends on the environments in which we live. Next, we need to explain our shared fate. People of all races want to live in clean environments with decent housing, good jobs, and high-quality schools. Next, we have to say how we got in this situation. For decades, low-income communities of color have been the dumping grounds for environmental hazards. We have to take on race directly. Having access to neighborhoods that support success should not be determined by your race. We have to reframe winners and losers. Corporations that contaminate our environments need to be held accountable. For our collective good, we need to value the quality of all of our neighborhoods above the profits for a few. We have to end with heart and with a solution. Join me in supporting legislation that will bring accountability to corporations. They need to pay their fair share so that all of us can have healthy environments in our communities. We have found that the ACT tool is very useful for framing conversations about racial equity. However, there's nothing more important than practice. So when you are reframing a conversation about racial equity, there's a few things for you to keep in mind. First of all, many people have thought about race from an individual perspective. We need to talk about race from a structural perspective.
It's important to remember that our messages are also in competition with individual implicit bias, as well as code words that call up negative racial stereotypes.
Framing matters. We have to attack the dominant frame and lift up inclusive values.
The dominant narrative on race is deeply interwoven into our understanding of government. Two of the meta frames that hold race in the United States are limited government and individual responsibility. These two frames, coupled with our ideas of meritocracy, can often make moving our own messages challenging. So that's the narrative that we're up against. If we want to get to a different narrative on the issues of race in the United States and normalize our conversations on race, that we understand both how race is playing out in our national narrative and the ways that we can interrupt it, disrupt it, and create a new narrative.